Hello friends, welcome to Smart News Digital. Today let's see the current affairs of 25th July 2018. The topics we are going to cover today includes G7. Let's see them in detail. The first topic we are going to see is about inter-creditor agreement which was signed recently. The Indian banks has been suffering from the non-performing assets problem for quite some time now. The inter-creditor agreement which was under the committee set up by the recommendation of banker Sunil Mehta is a great push for speedy resolution of non-performing assets on the balance sheets of various firms. This agreement has been brought in to solve the biggest problem of this agreement between the joint lenders, which involve both majority and the minority ones. The objection raised by very few lenders prevent the settlement between the majority lenders, which will now be solved with this agreement. The major points from the agreement include: the majority of representation by 2/3 of the consortium will be enough to override the objection coming from the minority. The minority lenders can either sell their assets or buy loans from other lenders at a premium price. This inter-creditor agreement deals with the resolution of accounts of value 50 crore and above that are under the control of the group of lenders. The whole agreement has been part of Sakshat plan which was brought in recently by the union government. The Sakshat plan provides a 5-point strategy to solve the NPA problem. The strategy include: bad loans will be classified into three major types. The first type includes loan up to 50 crores which are managed by the bank level and the deadline for which is 90 days. The second category of bad loans of category 50 to 500 crores will be dealt by the lead bank, or they can also be transferred to National Company Law Tribunal constituted under the Companies Act. The timeline for this plan is 180 days. And the third category of loan above 500 crore will be implemented by independent AMCs, which are asset management companies, and they can get institutional funding from the alternate investment fund. This whole idea is to consolidate the assets and solve the stressed issues problem. This agreement is very important in providing time-bound resolution plan for the NPA issue. This is a great improvement from the previous agreement under NPA issue, which solely concentrated on the joint lenders forum to arrive a consensus, which took a considerable amount of time. However, this agreement is not without flaws. The issues concerned with the agreement are: it is very difficult to quickly sale the stressed assets given under the arbitrary deadlines. The biggest obstacle for the agreement is the absence of buyers who can purchase the stressed assets, and also the unwillingness of the banks to sell the loans at deep discounted rates over the face value. These two issues are not addressed by the agreement. The second issue we are going to see today involves Lokpal Bill. Lokpal Bill and has been in news for a considerable amount of time right now. Recently, the Supreme Court has questioned the government's stand on the Lokpal issue, telling it's wholly unsatisfactory. Lokpal is nothing but the ombudsman to protect the common man from the corruption of the public service and the power centers. The court in the past several months has been constantly urging the government to complete the Lokpal appointment. The Lokpal Act 2013 requires the leader of opposition to be a part of the appointment committee to appoint the head of the Lokpal. So, this replacement of leader of opposition party by single largest opposition party leader has been taking quite some time now. The Supreme Court has completely dismissed the government's stand that it must wait until the amendment of 2013 Lokpal Act to replace the leader of opposition by the single largest opposition party leader. This is a short history of the long-drawn debate involving the Lokpal Bill. The whole idea about a Lokpal was constituted in the year 1963 when the parliament had a discussion about it in its budget session. Following it, in the year 1966, the first Administrative Reforms Commission was set up, and it recommended setting up of two independent bodies, one at the central level and other at the state level, in order to probe the complaints against the public functionaries, including the members of parliament. In the year 1963, the Lokpal Bill was introduced in the parliament for the first time, but it was not passed. Several attempts had been made from that year till 2011, but the bill has not been passed yet. In the year 2002, a new committee to review the constitution was set up under Mr. Venkata Chellaiah, and it recommended appointment of Lokpal and Lokayuktas. It also recommended that Prime Minister should be kept out of the whole ambit of Lokpal. In the year 2005, second ARC committee was set up, and it also continued to recommend the implementation of Lokpal without any delay. 2016, Lok Sabha finally agreed to amend the issues with regard to the 2013 Act. In the year 2017, a Supreme Court in a judgment regarding the Lokpal issue said that Lokpal appointment process should not be stalled merely due to the absence of the leader of opposition, who is an integral member of Lokpal selection committee as per the Lokpal Act 2013. The third issue we are going to see today is the passing of anti-graft amendment bill by the parliament. This anti-graft bill is amendment to the earlier Act of Prevention of Corruption Act 1988, and this bill seeks to punish both the bribe givers and the bribe takers. The bill provides a jail term of 3 to 5 years for the convicted civil servants for both the bribe giving and bribe taking. For the first time, the bill also differentiates between two types of bribe givers. Number one is collusive bribe givers, and second type is coerced bribe givers. The collusive bribe givers give bribes due to mutual benefit for both the parties. Factors like fear, they give bribe. And the coerced bribe givers are forced to give bribes because of the factors like fears or compulsion. And the act of bribe giving in both the cases must be reported within the time frame of 7 days to be considered under this bill. Some of the important provisions of the recent anti-graft amendment bill includes the following. First is regarding the bribery, which we saw before. And the second is regarding the pre-investigation approval. Under this bill, the police can begin the investigation only after prior approval from the government in case of the investigation dealing with the public servants. The third point is regarding the sanction for prosecution. The sanction is needed for prosecuting both the officers who are currently serving the government and also the former officials. And the fourth point deals with the criminal misconduct. The bill defines two types of criminal misconduct, which was earlier 5 types in 2013 bill. The two types are misappropriation of property to a public servant and intentionally enriching one's own property by a civil servant. This segregation of the conduct into two types is to prevent wrongful arrest of few officials, which has been a case recently. And the final part of the act talks with the setting up of special court in order to deal the anti-graft amendment bill. The fourth issue is regarding the anti-trafficking bill, which was in news for a couple of weeks by now. This bill was criticized by several eminent persons for being crime-centric rather than being human rights-centric. This bill diverges from the guidelines set by United Nations Human Rights Council in several ways. The guidelines mainly emphasis on the care for the people who are affected by the trafficking and also the involvement of the civil society, both of which are not considered in this bill. The fifth issue we are going to see today is regarding the concept of urbanization. Recently, the resident of small village in Bhavanpur, which is near Ahmedabad, has been protesting against the inclusion of the village in the city's urban area by the local urban development authority. And this issue is important from the context of the increase in the out-migration from the cities to villages, which has been taking place in the past decade. This article briefly discusses the reasons for the increased reverse migration which is happening in India. The first is due to the increasing pollution in the urban areas, due to which people are migrating back to their own villages. This is especially visible in the areas surrounding New Delhi, wherein the farmers are moving back to their villages from Gurgaon and Delhi area. Presently, almost 34% of India's population lives in urban areas, and it has been rising at a rate of 3% since 2011. And this increase is bluntly visible in smaller cities when compared to the larger cities like Mumbai, Kolkata. The increase in migration is not proportionally accompanied with increase in other infrastructure facilities. This has resulted in increased poverty and poor urban infrastructure, especially in the slum areas. The basic services like clean water, public transportation, sewage, and the housing facilities are in poor condition in almost all the cities, and this has led to several health crises and small outbreak of diseases in several slums. The Smart Cities program, which has been recently brought in by the government, lacks on the implementation front. The recurring floods in the Mumbai and dengue in Delhi and the fire incidents in lakes of Bangalore are complete manifestation of the increase in crisis in the urban areas. The urban infrastructure also suffers from the investment issues. For example, Jaipur and Bengaluru has collected only 5 to 20% of the potential property tax, and there's no systematic policy to deal with the urban migration. This has resulted in the crisis in connectivity and the transportation to rural and urban areas. Reforms are to be brought in this issue in order to bring in the inclusive development of India. The sixth issue is regarding special status to Andhra Pradesh. There has been a bun called by a political party in Andhra Pradesh for implementation of the special status to Andhra Pradesh state. The special category states will receive 90% of the total funds for centrally sponsored scheme in comparison to the 60% of the funds in case of normal category states. Currently, 11 states come under the category of special category states, which are mostly from the hilly region and the northeastern region. The five categories under which a special status to states are awarded include hilly and difficult terrain, low population density or high tribal population, strategic location along the borders, economic backwardness or infrastructural backwardness, and non-viable nature of the state's finances. The last issue we'll be seeing today is regarding the country Rwanda. Our Prime Minister has recently visited the country and he has gifted 200 cows towards poverty reduction and tackling childhood malnutrition program of Rwanda. Rwanda is an Eastern African country which is located near Uganda, Burundi, Democratic Republic of Congo and Tanzania. It is surrounded by lakes on its three sides. The lakes include Lake Ruvu, Lake Kivu and Lake Bulira. And the Rwanda has been in news for its 1994 genocide between the Hutu extremists and the Tutsi tribal people, due to which 1.3 million people were killed. And Rwanda is a member of United Nations, African Union, East African Community and also Commonwealth of Nations.